You're watching The Urban Debate on Mirror Now. I'm Faye D'Souza. The Indian banking system, we know, has plenty of problems already. Unpaid loans or NPAs running into 8.4 trillion rupees. Very, very low margins. Jewelry designers who make fools of the entire system and just walk away with 12,000 crore rupees in their pockets. As if the banking system needed any new problems, here is one more. And it's very serious. And the problem is bank robbers. Bank robbers who are sitting far away in different countries, hacking into the system to steal away all the money. This is the new Ocean's 11. A Pune-based Cosmos Bank was robbed on the 11th of August. And the scale and modus operandi of this particular cyber loot is a Hollywood script. This is how they did it. Target one. The first cyber attack was carried out on the 11th of August. Now, using a malware, the hackers got into the bank's debit card system. They used this information to clone thousands of cards. They used the dummy cards to carry out 14,000 transactions across 28 countries and withdrew a total of 80 crore rupees gone in a swipe. Target two, the bank robbers were on a roll. They transferred 13 crore rupees to an offshore account in Hong Kong using the SWIFT system. And if that sounds familiar to you, it's because you've heard it being mentioned during the Nirav Modi scam. It is the same system that Nirav Modi manipulated to rob us last year. I was not kidding when I told you that this is a Hollywood script. Now, initial investigations suggest the cyber attack could have been carried out from Canada, although we're not 100% sure. No arrests have been made and the police still don't know who robbed Cosmos Bank and its customers of nearly 100 crore rupees. The question that we have to ask is this. Did Cosmos Bank have a particularly weak security system? Or are all of our banks and all our money at risk of being nicked by robbers lurking on the internet? Now, Brijesh Singh, the Inspector General of the Cyber Crime Department of Maharashtra, was in Delhi today to brief the Finance Ministry. And he actually asked the government to send a notice to the RBI, asking the RBI to advise all banks to beef up their systems. This is what he told our reporter.
When these criminals are looking for infra to compromise, they are scanning everything. So it's not that which kind of bank. It is the vulnerable bank. So it may be a big bank, it may be a small bank. If you are slipping at one place, see, irony is that the cost of attacking is disproportionately lower than the cost of defense, as is in other security domains also. So anybody with basically off the shelf open source toolkits or exploits purchased on the dark web can try and get into your systems, and he needs only one foothold. Once he gets a foothold, he can do a lateral progression and start gaining privileges and then sit on your system, monitor your traffic and do whatever he wants. And this can happen not only in banking, it can happen in telecom, it can happen in other sectors.
Well, so the risk exists, but who holds the liability? Now, if the hackers are stealing from the bank, are they stealing the bank's money or are they stealing our money? Will the money go out of my account or will the bank take responsibility? Well, as per the RBI's rules, if a fraud occurs and it's not your fault or my fault, so as customers, we didn't leave our credit card lying around or give our passwords to anybody, then the bank must compensate completely. If it's nobody's fault, neither the bank's fault nor our fault, then the bank will compensate the customer up to a limit. Now, interestingly, there's been no specification on what this limit is, but that's where the RBI stands for now. And as we move faster and faster into a digital era with cashless transactions, we have to ask, are we ready? Is our money safe? Are our banks secure? That's the question we are asking this evening, and our phone lines are open. But joining me on the show, Bijoy Mishra, consumer expert, Vineet Goenka with the BJP. We also have Pawan Duggal, who's a senior advocate with the Supreme Court, Ritesh Bhatia, our cybersecurity consultant, Thomas Franco, general secretary of the All India Bank Officers Confederation, I beg your pardon, Ashwini Rana, vice president of the National Organization of Bank Workers. I welcome all of you gentlemen to this conversation. Mr. Pawan Duggal? Mr. Pawan Duggal is not with us yet. Ritesh, I'm going to ask you to do us a favor and explain to us, as if we were 5-year-olds, How money gets stolen out of banks? How does this work? How can someone reach into a bank from Canada and take out all the money?
So here, what has happened in a particular bank, if it has got very weak security measures. So today, you know, even moderate security measures for banking is considered to be very weak security measures. Okay. So somebody entered into the bank. Of course, this was because of the weak security measures.
And so someone hacked into the system.
Somebody hacked into the system. They installed a malicious software, which in short is called as a malware, or the common person calls it as a virus. They installed that. They replicated that entire payment application switch. They also got all the data, which was of like all credit card and the debit card holders' data. Now, it is because of this too that they were able to go, you know, they were able to clone the debit cards and then go to the ATM and withdraw all the money. So this is how it's really taken place. And it is just not this one thing. The second thing was also about the SWIFT transaction that happened. So if you see, there are two different networks were kind of compromised. Two different, you know, systems were compromised. One was everything to do with the payment applications, and the second was to do with the SWIFT thing. So it just shows the, you know, the kind of security measures that they had over there.
Well, Parliament was informed that during the year 2017, 53,000 cybersecurity incidents like phishing, website intrusion, defacement, viruses and ransomware attacks happened in our country.
Yes.
Now, in your experience and in your opinion, are our banks safe? Are they ready? Can they withstand attacks like this?
Now, cyber attacks are evolving every day. They are much, you know, the hackers are far ahead than any other cybersecurity experts or consultants or any other technology. They are far ahead, and like Mr. Brijesh Singh said, you know, the cost of an attack is much cheaper compared to the cost of, like, you know, what goes in defending. And secondly, if you see, you're talking about all these attacks. In December 2017, a very well-known company had also issued an advisory that this kind of hack will happen, and it's happening, and yet nobody took it seriously. So had they taken this particular advisory seriously, that was in December 2017, it's a very famous payment company, you know, who does all these security standards and all that. I don't think so we would be seeing something like this today.
All right. Vineet Goenka, is it necessary, in your opinion, for perhaps the RBI to ask banks to update their security and to constantly be vigilant?
See, what is happening is hacking or cyber crime is now not purely for financial reason. It is beyond financial reason. It's a psychological game also many times. Number two, they have gone beyond one particular instrument or one particular machine to enterprise-wide. So the challenge is becoming wider and wider every day. Now here we need solutions, and one of the solutions is putting in a security system which is 24/7, strengthening it. So we'll have to put in more systems around the systems which are existing right now. So probably RBI and also the ministry has to advise more things to all the banks who are concerned. Not only the banks, but financial institutions or institutions which hold data which can be vulnerable.
Well, that's a great answer. In the meantime, Mr. Goenka, if the money does get stolen out of the bank, will customers be made accountable? What if the money comes out of my account? Who's accountable then?
Well, you have already explained to this that there are already rules existing which says if there is not mistake of the customer does not take the brunt. It's the bank or the insurance or there are the system. Well, I'm not an expert, so I will not be able to comment on whether the bank takes the entire onus or there is a mechanism to reimburse it to the bank also. So probably we'll have to consult somebody from the bank. What is their guidelines? But there are guidelines which can be seen on the RBI website.
Well, those guidelines are not fully self-explanatory. Thomas Franco, General Secretary of the All India Bank Officers Confederation. Is there a risk to our money in the banks today from cybersecurity, Mr. Franco?
Faye, first of all, I would like to thank your channel and yourself for taking up these banking issues continuously, especially demonetization, the Nirav Modi scam, and I should thank you that the FRDI bill has been withdrawn today, mainly because of the media support we got for the campaign against the FRDI bill. Now coming to this issue, the customer will not be affected at all. The frauds are taking place, the hacking is taking place when there is this cyber crime is increasing day by day. Today, any system can be hacked. There are experts which are, as Ritesh Bhatia was also saying, there are experts who are much cleverer than the regular people who are guarding the system, and they are capable of hacking any system. But the customer of a bank will not be affected because it is the bank which is responsible to pay back whatever loss has been occurred because of this hacking. There are many cases, and RBI has also issued guidelines that when there is no compromise of your password, it is the bank which is responsible for repaying the money. Recently, I came of a case where one of my friends who had traveled abroad, taking an ICICI traveler's card, he used it in a place, he got a message that the transaction is declined, but 60,000 rupees was gone.
Yes.
So, hacking system has become so powerful, the banks are at a loss, but the customer at large, they don't have
but
to
you, Mr.
be worried
Franco.
Because if they have not compromised their password, yes.
Mr. Franco, in this particular case, of Cosmos Bank, the thief, whoever he was, took out 100 crore rupees. Can our banking system afford this kind of thievery?
See, banking sector has to update its system. They are constantly updating, but RBI is also issuing guidelines, but that is not adequate. What we require is a system which has to be much more powerful. But we are talking so much about digital banking, we are compromising in many security systems. Today, most of our systems, including this ATM machines and all the POS machines, they are all imported from China, which can be hacked very easily. So, it is necessary that the RBI comes up with adequate guidelines, that we develop our own adequate security system instead of depending on the security systems which we are purchasing at a huge cost, which is not really safe.
Well, Tarun Vig, co-founder of IEEFU, is on the phone line. He works with Brijesh Singh, who was the police officer who gave us this story. But Tarun Vig, here's my question to you. India is being pushed further and further into using digital money, which is the new way to go. But are we ready in the back end to take this sort of hacking?
So I would actually, you know, return the question back to you. Now, US, which is one of the most digitalized economies of the world, do we assume they are ready? In 2016, a hacking group called MoneyTaker ended up stealing $10 million from ATMs in US and Russia. So it would never, we can never, you know, in the digital world, you can never say that you are completely secure and, you know, hack-proof. It is never going to happen. Having said that, we cannot allow this incident to stop us from digitizing our payment transactions, which is you know, which the rest of the world is doing. All we can do at this end is to make sure that we try and stay one step ahead of the hackers by regularly doing carrying out penetration testing audit. As Mr. Thomas mentioned, we are spending a huge amount of money in importing cybersecurity equipment from countries like China, US, Israel. We don't even know whether that equipment in itself has a backdoor or whether that has been tested thoroughly. So the need of the hour is where RBI has to start developing these systems indigenously, where we have, you know, control over what we are coding, where we have control over how well we can protect those systems.
Well, Tarun, tell me this. You said we have to be one step ahead. How many steps behind are we at this point?
So think of it this way, right? When a cert impaneled auditor, you know, computer emergency response team auditor, you know, every bank is supposed to get an audit done by these auditors every year. Now, this guy is just doing his job. He will be paid X amount of money. He will come. He will use certain tools on your infrastructure and figure out whether there is a vulnerability which exists or not, a known vulnerability which exists or not. On the other hand, you have a hacker who's spending day and night in doing just one thing, trying to hack into your network. Now, in terms of dedication and commitment, you know, the hacker would always win.
In terms of dedication and commitment, the hackers would always win. I just want to take this over to Bijan Mishra, who represents the Indian consumer on this panel. Mr. Mishra, how does this make you feel?
Hello?
Well, I'm not sure if Mr. Mishra can... Bijan Mishra, can you hear
me? Yes. No, I
just got you. Yes, I couldn't catch up what you said. What did you say? Can you please repeat?
So we're being told that we're not safe. We're not one step ahead of the hackers at this point. A lot of the equipment that we're importing is from China, and it hasn't been thoroughly tested to see if there's a backdoor entry into the software. As customers, where does this leave us, Mr. Mishra?
No, we are disturbed. We are doubting the system. We feel that are we safe or not? So there is a huge amount of responsibility on RBI to ensure that, you know, they are able to win the faith of the citizens. So in one hand, we want to digitize, we want to go into modern technology, but on the other hand, we are not prepared and we are not ready to tackle the mischief, tackle the hackers, tackle the attackers, tackle the technology in a manner which needs to protect the consumer. So at the end of the day, what my view is, as somebody mentioned in this panel, that consumers are well protected. Well, we don't want only, you know, words to be told. We want it in practice. We want that if supposing tomorrow my account is hacked and without my fault, you know, my money got stolen, I must get the money back in 24 hours. And that is what the banks must ensure, and regulations must be made. RBI must make the rules and regulations, you know, updated in terms of relevant in today's context, which it is not. And in my view, we as consumers, we must feel very safe when we are transacting digitally. So many people, including me, many a times, we are shying away from going into digitized, you know, arena. We don't want to transact digitally because we are still scared. We are still not feeling safe. But at the same time, the Modi government is all the time talking about digitization. Everybody goes digital. But where is the protection? So we want a clear-cut guideline that if your money is stolen from your account, it will be reimbursed within 24 hours. We don't have to worry, because the insurance company is taking care, or the bankers are taking care to ensure that we are well protected, not only by words saying that the consumers will get their money back. We are not interested in such assurances. We want the money back in 24 hours in our account. How they do it, that is their business. Because we are, as citizens, as consumers, we are believing the bank and opening our account there, giving them the service charge, giving them all what they want in terms of minimum deposit, and all kind of norms to be followed for them to have a business model. So we must ensure that we get that service from them without any excuses, without any blaming game. They must work in a manner that we are one step ahead of the hackers rather than a step behind the hackers.
Well, I know Vineet Goenka is going to want to respond to the digitization bit, but I just want to read out what my team has found on the customer service arising on fraudulent and other transactions. So this is what the RBI says. In cases where the bank is at fault, the bank should compensate the customer without demur. In cases where neither bank is at fault nor the customer is at fault, but the fault lies elsewhere in the system, then also the bank should compensate the customer, in brackets, up to a limit, as part of the board-approved customer relations policy. Now, Mr. Ashwini Rana, Vice President of the National Organization of Bank Workers, would you be able to tell us what this limit is and what does this mean? Compensate the customer up to a limit as part of board-approved customer relations policy. What does that mean?
See, bank will see whether it is a fault of a customer or it is a bank. If bank is in fault, bank will reimburse 100%.
Okay.
Whatever amount their customer has lost, bank will pay. But if customer is at fault, bank will not pay anything, because so many customers feel that they are sharing their PIN, their passwords to someone else and they are being cheated, for that bank will not be responsible. Customer should be responsible, and they should know it. And in particular this incident, no customer has lost the money, whereas some customers have taken the advantage of this mischief, and they have taken 2, 3, 4 times money that they were knowing that their account is not being debited. So they went again and again to ATMs and they withdrawn the money. So this is a different case.
No, I just help me understand this, Mr. Rana. According to the RBI, if it is nobody's fault, if the fault is with the system, in this case, the fault would have been with the system. Or let's assume somebody took money out of 20,000 accounts, the fault would have been with the system. Who gets compensated in that case, and what is the limit that the RBI is
going to do? Bank will, this money is insured, bank will take the money from insurance, bank will give the money to the customers, the whole money.
Okay, so the customer gets compensated 100%. Vipin Malik joins us right now. He's the director, he's the former RBI director. Mr. Malik, thank you for joining us on the phone line. Here's my question for you. Is our money safe? Is our banking system safe? Are we doing enough? And are we staying up to date?
I think you're talking about the fraud took which was in Pune.
Yes, Costco's bank. Yes, yes.
Okay, because I'm out, so I'm not aware of what the conversation is. But let me tell you, this is not the bank fault at all. Bank is not in the full fault at all. This is a fraud which has happened in 34 countries. They have used the Visa card. The Visa card has been used by taking a debit to that bank account, which is a cooperative bank or some smaller bank, which doesn't have that much of net worth even. So the fault lies with the Visa. It has nothing to do with the system failure. It is the failure of the Visa internal problems. It's a credit card fault, company fault.
Would this then not be a problem with MasterCard, Mr. Malik?
It will be a problem with the MasterCard, yes. That's what I'm saying.
What about RuPay?
That is Indian.
So ultimately the currency is converted into RuPay.
The payment portal RuPay, RuPay, which is an Indian payment portal, was also hacked in this particular exercise.
Yeah, but through the MasterCard Visa.
No, so you're saying, Mr. Malik, that basically there's nothing we can do. People are going to hack and take the money out.
Yes,
it's going to happen across all countries.
Let me give you an example. In a Bangladesh bank, the Central Bank of Bangladesh, somebody used that account and took away thousands of crores rupees. So that was a different fraud. Here it is a MasterCard which has been misused and in the RuPay account.
No, Mr. Malik, there is something we can do. We can withdraw all the money from our bank accounts and keep it in a bag under our beds. It would probably be safer.
Well, I have no comment. In any case, 13 banks are in the preventive PCA, prompt corrective action. So on that, I don't have any comment. But the question you have raised me, I've answered you. It has nothing to do with that cooperative bank. It is a problem of MasterCard.
You haven't actually answered the question. Mr. Malik, we have today the IG Cyber Security Maharashtra, who has gone to Delhi to inform the IT ministry of how this particular crime took place. And he has advised the ministry and the RBI that all banks need to upgrade their security. This means that the bank security is not currently upgraded. It's not up to date.
The technology has to be upgraded every time when the new technology comes, when there's the fraud is happening, then they put some checks and all those fireballs. You see, here they have broken the fireballs. The fireballs are have been broken in a RuPay account.
Yes.
So I don't think that the bank has any liability at all, nor the bank should be worried about, or the Reserve Bank should be worried about, is a MasterCard.
No, but 100 crore rupees was still Indian money. Do you agree with this that it's Visa, MasterCard, it's not us?
He's contradicting because here he's saying that the firewall has been breached. So whose responsibility is if the firewall is breached? The firewall sits in the bank premises.
It's a MasterCard firewall.
How come the MasterCard firewall, sir?
Yes, it is MasterCard which...
Sir, the payment applications which has been compromised over here, So how can you say
no,
it
Malik
is just?
Is not aware.
In fact, Visa was the one
Malik
that alerted the bank that there is a fraud over here. Hadn't Visa alerted, it would have been like much more. It would have been more than 300 crores then.
Well, they have alerted or not.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
You cannot, nobody in a one branch of a small bank, that 100 crore rupees cannot be withdrawn.
Mr. Malik, let me just tell you what happened. So this is what happened. Somebody hacked into the debit card system of the bank, took out all of the details, with those details cloned the cards, and then in 28 different countries withdrew money from
in,
these
please?
Banks. So from these accounts. So the 28 different countries, it's not that this fraud happened to banks in 28 different countries. They used the cards of the Indian bank to withdraw money in different countries, because now these are all international cards. You can withdraw money from anywhere.
Yes, that is what I'm saying. So who's responsible? It is a MasterCard.
I disagree with you. Vineet Goenka, go ahead, please.
You can disagree with me, but this is my view.
Okay, fair enough.
I am giving you my view.
The MasterCard was not there only. MasterCard hasn't been breached also in this case. The MasterCard weren't used also. It's been Visa and RuPay debit cards.
There are, sir, I don't know whom I'm talking to. Mr. Chatterjee, the MasterCard have also certain limits. And those limits have all been breached.
Bro, this was Visa cards we were talking about, not MasterCards, Mr. Malik. But 1 second. Vineet Goenka, go ahead, please.
Sorry? You're talking to me?
My request to
Vineet
both the
Goenka.
Gentlemen is...
Yes, yes.
My request to all... Can I continue, sir? Mr. Malik, let me just come in, Mr. Malik, please. My name is Vineet Goenka. So, sir, my request to all the panelists would be, let the forensic investigations get over. We cannot jump to conclusions because these are complicated things. And this will come out only when there is a thorough investigation which is in progress will be completed. Now, here what we see is the major blame goes on Visa, prima facie, because Visa was more or less hacked. And the NPCI systems, as per the NPCI statement, was safe. Now, there can be challenges at every stage, whether it is the bank which was a challenge, whether it was the gateway or any other things. This will only come out when the forensic investigations are complete. So, we should wait for till that comes out. See, Ms. Faye, this is a cat and a mouse thing. Sometimes they are ahead of us, sometimes we are ahead of them. Criminals have been always a part of the society from the ages known. Even then, where there was criminal procedure courts, there were investigations, police and the courts. We have seen crimes been happening. This will happen. Now, the new types of crime will happen. Now, here, as a society, we have to train people, create awareness and also create laws. Also, technological changes have been done. If I can propose some solutions, that can be a two-factor authentication. We can have sovereign things which are there. The data can be sovereignly kept inside the precinct of the country. We can have indigenous production being done. So, these kind of solutions can come up. Yes, we need chief security officers in every bank who are 24/7 responsible for this, with a team which is trained perfectly by this. Whatever advice Brijesh Singh Ji has given today is a post-facto advice, and I'm sure the ministry and the RBI will work towards this. Now, we all have to come together and also create awareness within the customers of the banks, as a citizens also, that do not share your passwords, do not share your PIN codes. And this is a technological problem, this is a psychological problem. So, need not worry, there are people who are working on this. These kind of challenges always come to a society which is emerging and introducing technology. Digital India, it's a front-end thing which will take us to progress, and when we try to progress, there will be societal challenges within the country, also outside the country, which will try to put barriers to us. We cannot stop and see to these barriers. We'll face these barriers. We may fail at some times. We will learn lessons from that. So my request to
Mr. Goenka, from both Tarun Vig and Brijesh Singh, it seems like we're not prepared. The RBI made regulations that are now obsolete. They're not being updated. They're not inviting friendly hackers to try and see if the system is vulnerable.
I generally would not like to intervene to you.
Absolutely.
Do not jump to conclusion.
So,
you disagree. All right. Fair enough.
My request to you is that do not jump. I don't know what level the investigating officers have reached is not known to me. and may not be known to Riteshji also. So my request is, do not jump to this thing. Let the investigation officers do the investigation. This is something very complex, and we have to study this, whether it is done from the country or outside the country, whether it is done by individual or enterprise. So, you know, all this, whether it is a state which is involved, there will be various angles. When there is a progress happening in a country, there can be state angles also, whether they are an organization or it is an individual. Now, this will all come out when the forensic investigation is over. So, my request to you is that let the panelists not create any kind of impressions.
Ritesh, do you want to respond to that?
No,
let's just boil this down. One second. Mr. Mishra, I'll come to you. Ritesh, let me just boil it down to a yes or no question. Should we be concerned as customers, yes or no? Is there a risk?
Definitely there is a risk. We need to be concerned as customers, but at the same time here...
Concerned as a customer. I think there are people.
Okay, go on.
Okay, so we need to be concerned as customers because let me tell you, we need to be sure with bank we are dealing with. If a particular bank is not having adequate security standards, and if we want to continue with that bank, we are going to tell the bank that, look, certain things like PADSS or PCIDSS, these are like very stringent regulations that they should be adopting, they should be already having. And in cybersecurity, the main thing is about the emerging threats which are happening very frequently, and patching of systems and updating the systems is extremely important. So, Faye, interestingly, FBI had warned about this particular attack, which is going to happen worldwide. So this is nothing that's done internally in the bank or anything. It had already demonstrated this. It had sketched it out that this is the way it is going to be hacked. And it, unfortunately, it happened with one Indian bank of ours.
One Indian bank, but you know, I know Bijon Mishra wants to come in here with a point. Bijon Mishra, are you concerned? Do you believe we should be concerned?
Yeah,
after hearing what Ritesh just said.
We are extremely concerned. You see, we don't want any kind of a false hope given to us. You see, everybody in the panel steered out of your question in terms of who will define whose fault it is. How will you define whose fault it was? You see, you can always get away saying it was the customer's fault. How do we as customers get protected when it is not my fault? And we have to ensure that the regulator plays an unbiased role, and we
it has been told, sir, by various people in this panel, it's not customer's
fault. Mechanisms in place.
This is not,
I don't know why you're repeating the same thing again and again.
Customer is just not liable, and I think RBI has
again and again. I'm telling you,
sir, everybody's telling, why are you trying to create an impression, sir?
Faye has clearly asked you that there is a clause which says that if it is not bank's fault or customer's fault, it is the third party which will pay. Who is going to define that? Who is going to understand that? My money is stolen. I need that money tomorrow.
Why should the insurance company?
Please don't get hyper. Please do not mislead the audience.
All right. So, Mr. Mishra, let me clarify one more time. Gentlemen, allow me to clarify one more time, please. Mr. Mishra.
And then jump. And there are provisions. Customers are protected. Have you ever seen any customer in India being penalized? And is this the only bank? And I will also like to...
Mr. Goenka, we are now going to receive a flood of phone calls because you've asked that question. But all right, gentlemen, stop screaming at each other because I can't understand you anymore. I'm going to open up the phone lines for anyone who feels that they were penalized wrongly. You can call us. But let me clarify one more time. The RBI notice, and this was, again, this is the problem. This is what I keep bringing up, which I don't think anybody's really understood my question. This notice that I'm reading was back from 2002. Now, there is a need to update all the regulations based on how quickly we understand the cybersecurity threats are moving. Is that true?
Absolutely. With reference to Reserve Bank of India, they have updated it. These things are there. If you go and see on the, certain regulations also, it was there like last year also. Every time something happens, RBI, I think personally, is extremely active. So I don't see...
So where's the problem then?
From a consumer angle, there is no problem as such. The problem is in terms of inconvenience. Now, the hack in this particular case of Cosmos Bank, what happened? For 3 to 4 days, they couldn't use ATM, they couldn't use mobile banking, net banking, everything was like switched off. So, you know, the critical infrastructure was attacked. For them, it's their critical infrastructure. So they were locked out of the system, the Cosmos Bank. So there was an inconvenience.
The Cosmos bankers couldn't access their own, the banking customers couldn't the access customers their couldn't, own money for a
so
few,
it was
few
an
days.
Inconvenience, yes. Over there. Not that, you know, they are penalized or they lost money. No, nothing like that happened as such.
Right. Thomas Franco, here's the question again. While we update our system and become stronger, can this banking sector afford to lose 100 crore rupees in this manner?
See, one thing is that some of these arguments which are coming up that the customers don't have to be worried and the system will take care and all, and Visa will take care, the MasterCard will have to pay, these are all not correct. Visa is not going to pay, MasterCard is not going to pay, it is that particular bank has to prepay this amount to the customer. Where most of the cases, I come across hundreds of cases where when the customers complain of this kind of hacking and frauds, though they have not compromised their password, banks are always trying to protect themselves because they are going to lose the money. So they don't pay that money to the customer. So the customers are at risk as far as when the system is not foolproof. And RBI cannot say that we have issued circular, we have given warnings and all. It is the responsibility of the Central Bank, Reserve Bank of India,
that is exactly
to
what
establish
I'm saying.
A perfect foolproof system, which has not happened, which is not happening in this country. As I told earlier, we keep importing every software from countries like China, and we keep importing machines from China, and these are all not foolproof systems. So the customer has to be careful, the customer has to worry, and the banks have to improve the system.
Yes, Tarun,
the Reserve Bank also has to take up the responsibility to see that system is improved.
Right, Tarun Vig, here's the question.
Absolutely.
Now, India actually makes software
Absolutely.
For banking for the rest of the world, but the machine that we bring in, the ATM machines, the machines that actually read the checks, that do the work in the banks, those are not Indian, are they?
True, and they are not. They're imported. And even in this particular scenario, so a couple of facts, you know, people were discussing about this Cosmos banking hack attack. So in this particular case, see, Cosmos Bank was PCI DSS compliant. They are ISO 27001 compliant. They have gone through all those regulations and certifications that RBI mandates them to do so. On the other hand, the attack which happened was on a switch which they had imported from outside. I know the name of the company also. I don't want to reveal it here. So there's a name. There's a company whose switch they are using. That's the ATM switch. Hackers hacked into that switch, installed their malware on the switch, and in consequence, what happened was that every transaction that they were doing, the switch was not validating the transaction from the core banking solution. It was just sending an automatic approval. So no money has gone from a customer's bank account. The money which has gone is actually gone from the debt liability of the bank or the profitability of the bank. No money has gone from the customer's account because the transaction never ended up hitting the customer's account at all. This is the hacking attack which it has taken place. Coming to the second question, whether digitization is required. See, in US in 2016, similar hacking attacks happened. They lost $10 million across US and Russia. That does not prevent them from digitizing. They learned their lessons. They are evolving. And I guess that is what India needs to do as well. We can't stop digitization. It's the need of the hour. We will have to evolve, and we will have to keep or try and keep one step up, you know, ahead of the hackers.
Try and stay one step ahead of the hackers. And this is, I think, what Thomas Franco was pointing out, that we're not staying one step ahead of the hackers. In your opinion, Thomas Franco?
Yes, see, we are always trying to put the cart before the bullock. We announce things, we announce digital economy to be implemented without preparing adequately for the safeguard system. That is the flaw in our government's policies. It is a policy of the Reserve Bank is also responsible for that. See, first of all, you have to prepare the country for the digitalized economy, which you have not done. That is why increasingly more and more frauds are coming. Reserve Bank itself in its report has stated that the number of frauds are increasing day by day. So what steps we have taken to prevent these frauds? First of all, we have to safeguard our system. We have to prepare our system to be perfect. Then only we can move forward to that. I am not against technology. We have accepted technology in the banking system and it has helped the customers, it has helped the bank. But recently we are seeing that we are just pushing things so fast without preparing the system to be supportive of that. That is where the default comes in.
But we have Pavan Dugal who joins us right now. Pavan Dugal, the conversation is about the safety of Indian banks post the hacking of Cosmos Bank in Pune. Now, we understand that while the investigation is on and they have so far narrowed it down vaguely to perhaps Canada, we have no other information on who these people could have been and how we're going to get that money back. Do you see this as a reason, as reason for concern, Mr. Dugal?
See, obviously these issues are bound to be of major concern, primarily because once we've already seen a wake-up call in the last incident, it's time to have things in place. I take you back to the year 2011, the Reserve Bank of India had actually constituted the G. Gopalakrishna Working Group, of which I was also a member. And we had, in our report, had actually stipulated the various specific steps that need to be done and taken by banks for the purposes of protecting and preserving their cyber security and information security. These reports were subsequently notified by the RBI, but we do find that large number of these smaller banks have still not totally complied with these parameters. So in a context like this, where this kind of attacks are bound to happen on a daily and an hourly basis, the question is, we need to be prepared in terms of our preparedness of how to deal with this from a legal standpoint. Why? Because if that's not going to happen, it's going to unnecessarily expose the relevant actor in the banking sector to unlimited damages by way of compensation under the Information Technology Act 2000. And that's not good news. Already banks are pushing the implementation of the 6th July 2017 notification of the RBI, where the RBI said that if people are complaining to you for some transactions done not done by them, then you have to absorb the loss provided it's complained to you in 3 days. So I think the response mechanisms have been very tardy. We still have not learned. We are, as a nation, perennially in a sleeping mode. We believe in complacency as our default option. And we believe that we are the most lucky people in the world and nothing else is going to happen. So in this kind of a situation, wake-up calls are constantly being given to us by hackers, by cyber criminals, by state and non-state actors. If we are still not able to open ourselves to and our eyes to these kind of wake-up calls, then I think there is a disconnect, because at the end of the day, people's lack of confidence is appearing.
Well, Mr. Dugal, here's the question. Let's say the RBI has in fact made regulations. Is there enough enforcement of those regulations? Can the government just leave it to the RBI to enforce regulations on cybersecurity?
Well, currently we've only seen some kind of notifications. None of these have been effectively implemented. In fact, there are no even specific legal provisions of what will be your liability in case if you do not really comply with these provisions. You see, please understand, as a nation, we don't have a national cybersecurity law in place. The nation has seen how our national cybersecurity policy of 2013 has just remained a mere paper tiger and is not being implemented. So however brilliant provisions the RBI is going to come up, or the central government is going to come up, the fact still remains is that if it's not going to be effectively enforced by efficient, effective mechanisms, it's not going to be complied with. Let's take the notification of 4th of January 2017 of the Indian Computer Emergency Response Team that actually mandates every body corporate, and mind you, every bank in the country is a body corporate, every body corporate, every service provider, to mandatorily report 10 different kind of cybersecurity breaches that happen on their systems and networks. And when you look at the actual breaches that have happened versus the actual reportings that have happened, you'll be surprised. The reportings are so low that it's hard to believe that you are in a country like India. It appears more like a place where it's utopia and there's no attacks on Indian networks. But the fact remains is, because there is no deterrent mechanism, if you do not report, there's nothing waiting for you as a penal consequence thereof, you invariably do not yes. even land up following that particular mandate. So I think it's high time both the RBI and the government comes up with strong deterrent mechanisms to implement whatever existing that they have, apart from coming up with more cogent legal provisions to protect cyber security.
Do you agree with him? I saw you nodding.
Yeah, completely. I mean, you know, we really need, because as I told you earlier also, RBI has amazing guidelines, the way IRDA has, IDA has, and you know, other, so here, but then you know what, I personally feel certain banks are not taking it very seriously. So this really needs
it's
to be enforced.
Priority.
Yeah, it's like on a low priority and this thing. Because cybersecurity is a hectic work. You really need a big team continuously monitoring and all that. So they aren't. So there, as Mr. Pawan Dugal rightly said, there needs to be some penalty on these people if they're not going to take it so seriously. So hence the government needs to enforce it that this is taken seriously and you don't do it.
You know, we had Tarun Vig and Brijesh Singh also tell us that you need to actually organize hackathons, you need to invite people to test your system.
Bug bounties,
yes.
Things like these. But then when we try to do that, we served with notices also.
You served with notices.
So people are scared. People are scared to do that.
All right, we're going to wrap this up because we've run out of time. But this is what it winds up. This is what people have told us on the panel so far. There is a very real risk through cybersecurity or the lack of it on Indian banks and the money in Indian banks. The good thing is, if it's not your fault, you cannot be penalized. The money should come into your account. Unfortunately, not in 24 hours. Sometimes it takes 7 working days to do so. This means that you need to be super, super careful to make sure that it's not your fault, which means never share your PIN, never share your OTP, never leave your credit card lying around as far as possible. Be extremely careful with your cards, your passwords, your PINs, and your one-time passwords or the OTPs that come to your phone. Secondly, the RBI has made regulations, but they're not being enforced and most banks are not taking them seriously. And that could perhaps cost us dearly going forward. There is a need for very strong enforcement that runs more than a rap on the knuckles, which is what the RBI normally gives an erring bank. We might walk away saying, as customers, we don't have to worry, but as a country, can we afford to lose 100 crore rupees in one day to a bank robber who's sitting halfway across the world? We need the government, the RBI, and the police to be more vigilant about our banking system. Thanks for watching.